spent nearly a year with Donald Trump writing the book, The Art of the Deal. He spent hundreds of hours with him, and in a new op-ed in the Washington Post, he says that President Trump is doing what Citizen Trump always did, reacting impulsively and defensively, blaming others and inventing stories that don't depend on facts. Tony Swartz joins us now. So, Tony, I mean, I read your op-ed. It was fascinating. Knowing the president like you do, and you did, I mean, you spent an awful lot of time over the course of that year. How do you think he's handling and has handled all of this information, but also the news of a special counsel being appointed?
I think he's in a pretty significant meltdown, Anderson. I think that the sense of siege that he feels because his sense of self-worth is so, so vulnerable, that the series of things that have happened have been overwhelming to him. I think he's reacting from, as I say in the piece, I think he's reacting from a survival place. I think he's being run by the part of his brain that is reactive and impulsive, not capable of reflection. And I think he's in pure defensive mode.
I want to go deeper on that, because one of the things you write about, and this is based on your experiences with him over so long a period of time and getting into his head, is that he basically, you wrote that he kind of lives his life in survival mode, that every interaction with him, it's about winning it or losing it. It's a binary choice. You're either a winner or a loser, and this goes back really his entire life.
Yeah, it goes to his very early childhood with a very brutal, difficult father with whom, by his own definition, he had a business relationship. And guess what? From the perspective of attachment, you can't grow up in a healthy way if you lack love from a parent. And the only parent that he valued was his father. His father overwhelmed or overpowered his mother as well.
It's interesting. So his mother really, the only photograph he has behind his desk in the Oval Office, or at least did for a long time.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, there's a kind of omerta there. There's a family kind of loyalty, although it's been fascinating to me to watch that an evidence of his meltdown is the fact that he started to scream at Jared Kushner. Honestly, I think his kids are next, and I guess his boys he doesn't need to worry about or blame because they're not part of it right now. But I can honestly easily see him going after Ivanka if she says the wrong thing right now. One of the things I say in this piece is that I remember very vividly when I was working with him, how terrified people would be of going up against him in any way when you could sense that he was feeling the way I guarantee you he is feeling right now.
You point to the fact that in the hundreds of phone calls that you listened in on, with his consent, I should point out, in all those meetings you went to with him, you never remember anyone ever disagreeing with him to his face. I mean, does he want anyone to disagree with him? Because that's one of the questions is, does he have people around him who can say, you know what, you shouldn't get on the Twitter machine right now, or you should, you know, not say this.
Anderson, this is the most important thing. We've normalized a person who is not in any way normal. Now, I recognize that there are plenty of critics now out there, but this is not a person operating according to ordinary human expectations. And so,
although I would push back on that, is anyone who reaches the level of president operating, you know, I mean, to do what it takes to get to that level, it's an extraordinary level of achievement. I'm not sure it's the normal.
No question. But what he lacks, as I say, because he was so involved in defending himself and still is he lacks the qualities that you ordinarily see in someone as they mature, as they grow more secure. So he lacks empathy, the ability to really connect with other people, self-awareness, and above all, a conscience, a clear distinction between right and wrong. There is no right and wrong for Trump. There's winning and losing, and that's very different than right and wrong. And right now, he is in pure terror that he is going to lose. And by the way, he is going to lose. I surely believe that at some point over the next period of time, he's going to have to figure out a way to resign. And the reason he's going to do that, as opposed to go through what could be an impeachment process or a continuing humiliation, is that he wants to figure out a way, as he has done all his career, to turn a loss into a victory. And so he will declare victory when he leaves.
You know, you wrote that beneath his exterior, you said you sense, quote, a hurt, incredibly vulnerable little boy who just wanted to be loved. I think a lot of people might be surprised to hear that. But I know, you know, I mean, my interviews with him and other people I've talked to who spent time with him, there is this need of him. I've never met somebody at his level who does kind of look for approval in some way from, you know, you can, if you give him a compliment, you can see it wash over him.
No question. I mean, he lives in deficit, and I describe him in this piece as a black hole that you pour adulation and achievement and conquests into him, and it just pours out the other end. It doesn't stick. And all I think he wants is for people to love him. Now, that's really dangerous because he wants people to love him and to adore him so much that he would like not to have any dissent. So he would like not to have a free press because they criticize him. And he would like not to be involved in being president in a democracy because that allows people to disagree with him. So those authoritarian instincts are really psychological and emotional, not ideological.
I remember something you tweeted out, it might have been a year ago, but it stuck in my mind, and I've always kind of thought about this when I read the president's tweets or things he says, that the criticisms he makes of others, the attacks that he launches on other people, the actual adjectives that he used, I don't want to paraphrase you too much, but that the adjectives he used to attack other people is what he actually thinks of himself. So when he calls Comey a grandstander, it's actually what he thinks of himself. When he says somebody is weak, that's what he worries about himself. Am I characterizing what you said correctly?
Very accurately. I mean, it's projecting onto others what he sees in himself and cannot own or must disown. And that is, if you look at his tweets, it would be wonderful for somebody to do a PhD thesis on this. If you look at his tweets, any ones that relate to other people, I think you can find an amazingly consistent pattern and actually a very accurate self-portrait. I'd love to see somebody do that because the attacks are exactly, you know, Jung would have called this the shadow. They're exactly the aspects of himself that he finds most intolerable.
Man, I'm never going to have a ghostwriter because you know